What a great morning, hey? Amen. Yeah. For the children that are on holiday, it's great. For us, it's great. Yeah, I'm just very expectant of what God wants to do. Do you know, have you ever wondered, this has got nothing to do with my sermon, but have you ever wondered why churches is raked a bit like that? Hey, in that little arc at the front. A lot of you think it's because of your neck and it's an easier angle. Okay, maybe, yeah, David says it could be to dance, but it's actually called the spitting zone. So the more fervent the preacher, the further back they have to put the chairs to save the people in front. That's why, have you ever wondered, you walk in church and you see the front rows a bit empty? Because they know, they didn't bring their umbrella or their raincoat. No, I'm joking. So we need to bring it forward, eh? Yeah, I'm really, this morning, I want to say, unless you're a doctor, please put your phone off. Leave your WhatsApps. Just I want you not to focus on me. I actually, just on my way here this morning, I thought, Lord, I just wish sometimes we could put just a blank screen here, that people don't see me. You know, even when Jesus, and I'm not saying I'm Jesus, but when Jesus went to his hometown, sometimes who the person is blocks the message. And, you know, I often laugh. I understand when God says he uses the donkey or the foolish things of the world. I then know why I have this job. Because I realize when I look in the Word just how inadequate we are in our own strength. And that's why when we stand here, we don't stand ever. You know, Grant said, how are you this morning? And I said, no, you know that feeling. And I saw this look in Grant's eye. He goes, yeah. That feeling you get, not about failure, but about, Lord, let them hear you today. And let what we say change someone's life. You know, the reality is, I don't know if all 600 or 700 people here this morning are going to get touched or moved, but we pray that one person hears what God is saying, that person that needs it. And that's why we come. You know what? God can use the same message, and you're in an entirely different circumstance to someone else, and God will use you. So, yeah. So, I want to take you back to the year 2006. I'm going to bare my soul a little bit for you guys. I'd been in my own business for 3 years. I studied for 6 years, and went overseas and worked for a year, came back and started a business. And we had just come through in the beginning, or the end of 2005, our best months ever. We smashed all our records. We did in basically 1 month what we had done in half a year. And things were going amazingly well. Andrew and I would be getting engaged. She didn't know at the time, but I'd been making plans to get a ring and to get engaged. The business was growing, and I was seeing God's blessing in our lives. We were involved in ministry. We were involved in reaching out. We were doing connect groups and cell groups, and we were really involved in what God was doing. But suddenly, we got to the end of January 2006, and I suddenly noticed I didn't get the SMSs on my phone, you know, to tell me that there'd been some deposits. And the problem is with good sales, it means you've given a lot out. I was in a product-related industry. So I've given a lot of product out, and I'm waiting for the money to come back. And nothing came through. And in the space of about 3 months, our business that was heading up was suddenly heading down very fast. Just in the space of that December, January, and then into February, the payments hadn't come through. March, the payments hadn't come through. We lost about 400,000 rand in my business. And that was through primarily two people. The one company went bankrupt. They were doing a big job, and anyway, they had gone bankrupt. And then this other guy, when I phoned him, he said, "Ach, well, sue me. You'll get nothing. I've got nothing in my name." And that was his attitude. He owed me 150,000 rand. And anyway, our company was basically on the stage of being bankrupt ourselves, and we faced these challenges. But God just somehow, kind of almost at the bottom of the... Just gave us some wisdom. Just gave us some things to do. And we got out of it. And there was no overnight miracle, but we didn't close the doors. Still, some people were getting their salaries and families being fed. But this again happened in 2009. Very similar. I remember the one day, also through the December, January. And I suppose you can all figure out I was in the building industry, yeah. Anyway, I remember praying and asking God, "Lord, please come through." And I've been through this before. I don't like this feeling of not knowing, am I going to be able to pay my staff? Are the lights going to be on? Am I going to be able to pay cell phones? How embarrassed I feel to phone the factory and tell them I'm late with all these things that I was going through. And I did, you know what any, I think, Christian does. I prayed really hard. And I had two great friends, and they made time, and every afternoon after I'd close up shop, they would come to my shop and pray with me. And we would pray and pray and pray, and we would pray over my shelves, and we would pray over my debtor's book and the money that was due to be coming in that wasn't coming in. We'd pray for miracles. We'd pray for contracts to come through. We'd just pray nonstop. And I'll never forget the one day my shop had a front section, and then it was an old house that had been transformed. And in the back, I was just praying on my own, and I just felt God stop me. And he said, JJ, this business isn't your provider. I am. Hey, I am. Remember Moses heard those words, eh? I just clearly just remember God saying that. And some of you might be offended that I've got a tattoo. But the reality is after that, that's when I decided to get that tattoo. And it's Hebrew writing for Jehovah Jireh, God provides. And I did that because I needed to be reminded. It was the second time, and I kept trying to rely on my own strength. And I knew that every day of my life, I need to be reminded that God is my provider. Anyway, I just remember this just so amazing, and I called the guys that were in the shop with me, and I said, come, let's stop praying. And they were like, yeah. And I said, no, God's just spoken to me. And I said, guys, you know what? I don't want us to pray for any more miracles. I don't want us to pray over the shelves that suddenly we have a massive turnover. I don't want to do anything. I just want us to praise God, even right here where we are. I just want to praise God where we are and worship Him. And we had on the computer some worship, and we put the worship up, and we just worshiped God. I had it all worked out, you know. Previous, all my prayers, I had it all worked out. I had a plan. You know, while this was all going on, I'm thinking, oh, but Lord, I remember, you know, we bought a property last year, my brother-in-law and I, and some of them were selling for a really good price. We're going to do this and this, and we'll make a couple of million, and I'll be able to pay what I owe and slowly get that money in. And I had this plan worked out in my head. I was kind of like talking it out so that God would hear my good plan and hoping that, yes, this was going to be the plan. But it never happened. And on top of this, this was just after we had heard the most amazing news that the devil tried to steal from us, was that we were expecting our firstborn son. We didn't know it was a son yet, but we knew we were expecting a child. And the stress was unreal. And again, I remember in that time, God saying, JJ, this business is not your provider. I am. It's just a means I use. I can use anything, but this is just a means I use. So this isn't the part where I tell you about a big miracle. Through a series of events, I basically had to give the business away to someone that was a friend. And with 3 months till my son was going to be born, I'd lost my business and I had no job. I don't know if it's just me, but one thing I've noticed is that God's not always in the logical step, is he? Hey, we have this logical, but Lord now. And he doesn't seem to be in our logical step. And I want us to go to scripture now. Exodus 3 verses 1 to 4 in the NIV says this. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in the flames of the fire within a bush. Moses saw that the bush was on fire and it didn't burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up. And when the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here I am. So remember where Moses had come from. Moses was, for lack of a better word, a prince. He was a prince in Egypt. He lived in a palace. He grew up probably with many luxuries, knowing that he was different, probably. And all those events had led to him killing the guy and running away. But Moses was once in the place where it was going really well, and now he was tending sheep. And it doesn't say on the far side of the wilderness. You can just imagine that journey. A guy that's been living a great life, in the worldly sense, suddenly he's in the wilderness and walking in the wilderness, and God spoke to him. And not just that, he responded and God changed the entire world through him. He changed the Israelites' future. So we go on again, and I'm reminded of the words that I remember God speaking to me. And he told Moses, he said, just tell them, I am sent you. And again, those words just ring true. From this place in the wilderness, God says, I am. Moses obeys God after really offering up quite a few excuses or why it wouldn't work. And anyway, he gets there and he faces Pharaoh, who's still mistreating the Israelites, and says to release the Israelites. But it's quite interesting what he says when he says release the Israelites. In Exodus 8 verse 27, it says, we must take a 3 days journey into the wilderness to offer sacrifices to the Lord our God as he commands us. Another version actually says to go into the wilderness to worship the Lord. So it's funny. Maybe if I'd written this part of the Bible, I would have thought the Lord would say, we're going to have a 3-hour walk, not a 3-day walk. And we're not going into the wilderness. I'm going to take you to a beautiful beach. Don't you think that that's what we, when we wrote the Bible, that's what we would have thought? Yes, Lord, you're going to deliver us from being slaves into a desert. But there's a beach. Just, Lord, just east of us, here's a beach. I would love to go there. But God didn't do that. He didn't call them to the easy life. He called them into the wilderness. And this is where God reminded me of yet another story of where God doesn't maybe do things the way we thought he would do it. You know, and the Bible is written that we recognize these stories because then we go, I remember that in my life, something similar. And in Judges 7 verse 4, it says this, the Lord said to Gideon, and this is when they had to go fight the Midianites, a massive army. But the Lord said to Gideon, there are still too many men. Take them down to the water, and I will thin them out there for you. If I say, this one shall go with you, he shall go. But if I say, this one shall not go with you, he shall not go. So Gideon took the men down to the water. There the Lord told him, separate those who lap the water with their tongues as a dog laps water from those who kneel down to drink. 300 of them drank from cupped hands, lapping like dogs. All the rest got down on their knees to drink. And the Lord said to Gideon, with 300 men that lapped, I will save you and give the Midianites into your hands. Let all the others go home. So Gideon sent the rest of the Israelites home, but kept the 300 who took over the provisions and the trumpets of the others. Aren't you glad they left the trumpets? I read that. I'm like, Lord, they left the trumpets. This is amazing. They're going into battle. They left provisions and trumpets. So anyway, again, we know how the story pans out. Gideon is really actually quite freaked out. I mean, he started with 30,000 men. He's now down to 300 men with trumpets. You know, and he's going to face a massive army that he knows it's going to be scary. And God says to him, you know what, if you're nervous, take someone with you and creep into the camp and listen to the first tent. And they get there and they hear the guy saying, oh, I had this dream. And in this dream, we were beaten, basically. And the guy goes, that must be Gideon and his army. And this rumor starts spreading that Gideon and the army are going to overthrow them. They've got no idea that Gideon has just whittled down his army to 300 people with trumpets. You know, and again, I'm sure imagine Gideon, I mean, I think Gideon's brave, but imagine being one of Gideon's men that decided to stay. They also had a heck of a lot of faith, knowing and trusting that Gideon had heard from the Lord. But he obeyed God nonetheless. And they got a massive victory, you know, when they shattered the clay pots and the lights came on and the army started killing themselves and they won a massive victory. Anyway, and the third story I want to touch on, and again, I'm just developing this pattern we see in the Word that God doesn't always do things the logical way or the way you think it would happen or I think it would happen. And this is about when King Saul is going to try and give David his armor. We know Goliath's tormenting, and in those days, the armies would often send a champion out to save the lives of the soldiers. They would send the champion out, they will fight, and whoever lost, then the whole army surrendered to the other army. So this is all happening in the background, and we know David gets called from the Bundus. Three of his brothers, not all of them, 3 of the 7 are out, and David is the skivvy that gets sent with some bread and cheese for his brothers. Anyway, and we're going to read 1 Samuel 17:34 to 39. It says, but David persisted, because he wanted to go and take on the giant. I've been taking care of my father's sheep and goats, he said. When a lion or a bear comes to steal a lamb from the flock, I go after it with a club and I rescue the lamb from its mouth. If the animal turns on me, I catch it by the jaw and club it to death. I've done this to both lions and bears, and I'll do it to this pagan Philistine too, for he has defied the armies of the living God. The Lord who rescued me from the claws of the lion and the bear will rescue me from this Philistine. Saul finally consented. All right, go ahead, he said, and may the Lord be with you. And then Saul gave David his own armor, a bronze helmet, a full coat of mail. David put it on, strapped the sword over it, and took a step or two to see what it was like, for he had never worn such things before. I can't go in these, he protested to Saul. I'm not used to them. So David took them off again. And here again we see a story that God decided to do things maybe not the way we would have done it. The Bible says that Saul was 7 foot tall. I mean, that's taller than our tallest springboks. 7 foot, a massive guy. In my story, it was King Saul who would defeat the giant in the battle. For the books, it would have been a battle for the books. I could imagine the headline in all the papers. King defeats giant in epic showdown. Hey? Again, I ask myself, Lord, why? Why the wilderness? Why do we see so many times we in the wilderness? You're probably all thinking that. And that's why today I thought, I don't need anything on stage with me. I think all of you immediately identify with the wilderness you're either in right now or the wilderness you've been through. I've often asked myself about these experiences, what I'd been through, what I've seen so many friends go through. I've struggled and walked with friends and family as they go through these terrible things. Anyway, back to my story when I'd lost the business. I remember reading a very well-known scripture. You all know about it. And in the scripture, it's when Jesus had been baptized and the Holy Spirit had descended on him in the form of a dove. And then the Bible says something interesting, that he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. Jesus was led into the wilderness. And again, the wilderness. Not a holiday camp where he could quietly meditate on the Lord and just praise God at his goodness with grapes around him and just a good time. No, he got taken into the wilderness. And not just that. It says he was taken to the wilderness to be tested. And then there's the part where the devil says to Jesus, Jesus, why don't you turn these rocks into bread? And it's quite funny because the Bible goes, and Jesus was quite hungry then, hey, after 40 days. Anyway, and the devil comes and says, why don't you turn this into bread? And then Jesus replies, and you all know this, I believe, a famous, famous words. He says, man should not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of the Father. And this is from Matthew 4, verses 4. And now I know we've all been taught how, so often that Jesus used scripture. Jesus used scripture to stand against the devil. And when you're in a hard time, you use scripture to stand against the devil, to against the lies or against the challenges that you're going through. And it's quite funny. I knew that Jesus quoted the scripture, but I'd never thought, but where does this come from? Have you? I don't know if I was the only one. But I'd never looked, where did this come from? I mean, I know a couple of times, and in my Bible, you see the little numerals on the top, the superscript to show its reference, but I never looked. And I thought, you know, I've just been going through this time. I've got no job. Jesus said, man should not live by bread alone, but every mouth. And the Spirit just prompted me to go and look where it came from, because I knew it was from Scripture. I didn't know where. And that's where we get to Deuteronomy 8, verses 2 to 5. That's where it came from. And it says this, remember how the Lord your God led you all the way in the wilderness. Again, we see in the wilderness, eh? These 40 years, to humble and test you in order to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commands. He humbled you, causing you to hunger, and then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your ancestors had known, to teach you that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Your clothes did not wear out and your feet did not swell during these 40 years. Know then in your heart that as a man disciplines his son, so the Lord your God disciplines you. Do you know the Israelites had been captive so long? They'd been, I think it's 400 years in Egypt. They'd been captive for so long they actually didn't know how to worship anymore. God needed their full attention, and he knew he had to lead them to a place where they could learn who he really was. Because again, in our mind, we've got this, but Lord, when you save me, everything is going well. And that's one of those little lies the devil drops into you. Because we read about all these things, and it's so ironic that Grant had no idea what I was preaching on, but that he spoke. One of the scriptures I wanted to use was Psalm 23, when we're going through that shadow of the valley of death. He knew he had to lead them to a place where they would learn who he is and how to worship him. We see that God led Jesus into the desert. He led the Israelites into the desert and a trap. They not only went into the desert, but he took them into a desert and then towards a sea. And Moses was from the desert, and they knew in those parts there's a sea there, but they followed and they went where God told them to. We see how David was shaped in the wilderness in this alone time. Again on David and Goliath, God never uses things the way we would. What did David do? He rejected the armor and the weapons that he was offered, and he went with what he knew. He went with what he had learned in the wilderness. With what God had showed him in the wilderness, he learned about God's faithfulness, God's protection, God's provision. He knew how to use his sling in the desert. I can imagine just nonstop. I mean, you're watching sheep all day. Just imagine how good he got to that sling of his. And he went with God and his sling and five stones. And to top it off, he didn't tentatively face Goliath. He reminded himself what Goliath was doing, and he ran at Goliath to take him on. And 1 Samuel 17:40 puts it so well. It says, yeah, he picked up five smooth stones from a stream, put them into his shepherd's bag, and then, armored only with his shepherd's staff and sling, he started across the valley to fight the Philistine. I want to remind you again, God doesn't do things the so-called logical way. I mean, God could have given Goliath food poisoning. Would it be maybe easier, hey? The scripture in 1 Corinthians says it so well, and this is really, for me, this is where God started uncovering a lot of my, Lord, what's going on here? And I think we all face. And I'm reading from the New Living Translation. It says, the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are headed for destruction. But we who are being saved know it is the very power of God. As the scriptures say, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and discard the intelligence of the intelligent. So where does this leave the philosopher, the scholar, and the world's brilliant debaters? God has made the wisdom of this world look foolish. Since God in his wisdom saw to it that the world would never know him through human wisdom, he has used our foolish preaching to save those who believe. It is foolish to the Jews who ask for signs from heaven, and it is foolish to the Greeks who seek human wisdom. So when we preach that Christ was crucified, the Jews are offended and the Gentiles say it's all nonsense. But to all those called by God to salvation, both Jew and Gentile, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. This foolish plan of God is wiser than the wisest human plans. And God's weakness is stronger than the greatest of all human strength, eh? What an amazing truth. What an amazing truth. How often have we sat questioning God, but why are you doing this? Why did I have to go through that? Why did my friend have to experience this? Trust me, I sat listing all the things I've done for you, Lord. Lord, I'm tithing. We go and feed people in the middle of the night that don't have homes. Lord, I go to church all the time. I pray. I have quiet times. What's the problem with all of those prayers? All of them are looking at my goodness. I want to follow this vein of God's wisdom. Romans 11:33 says this, oh, how great are God's riches and wisdom and knowledge. How impossible it is for us to understand his decisions and his ways. Why do we try? Why do we try so hard to understand what God is doing? You know, one thing I've realized, when he wants you to understand, you'll understand. Isaiah 55, one we all know, says this, verses 8 and 9. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. I wanted to also read it from the message in a paraphrase version. I think it says it quite beautifully. I don't think the way you think. The way you work isn't the way I work, God decrees. For as the sky soars above the earth, so the way I work surpasses the way you work, and the way I think is beyond the way you think. Just as rain and snow descend from the skies and don't go back until they've watered the earth, doing the work of making things grow and blossom, producing seed for farmers and food for the hungry, so will the words that come out of my mouth not come back empty-handed. They'll do the work I sent them to do. They'll complete the assignment I gave them. Isn't that quite reassuring? We might not know what's going on, but God does. We see the reason God does things different is because we just don't see what he sees. We don't see the way he sees it sometimes. We can take comfort that when we find ourselves in the wilderness, because if history is something to go by, we're going to find God in that desert and in the wilderness. So why the desert? Why the wilderness? Deuteronomy 8 further down says this, he led you through that vast, dreadful wilderness, that thirsty, waterless land with its venomous snakes and scorpions. He brought you water out of hard rock. He gave you manna to eat in the wilderness, something your ancestors had never known, to humble and test you so that in the end it might go well with you. You may say to yourself, my power and my strength of my hands have produced this wealth for me. But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth and so confirms his covenant, which he swore to your ancestors, as it is today. So why the desert? Why the wilderness? He wants to lead you. I think in the wilderness, it's a place where we don't know really where we're going. You know, have you ever seen a picture of a desert and you have no landmark to work from? You're like, well, I don't know which way to go. You know, my family, we were in the Tsitsikamma forest, and I suppose that you walk into some of those forests and you don't see the sky, you don't know where the sun is, you can get lost so quickly. And I think that's the one thing God's saying. When you're in the wilderness, it means you have to rely on me to lead you. When we think we know where we should be going, we tend to try to do it without God. But in the wilderness, the Israelites would only move when they saw either the pillar of cloud moving or the fire at night. And this is where I want to ask you. Are you following God or are you following your own wants? Are you following God or what you want? Is he leading you daily because he wants to? He wants you to know that he's the one that will supply what you need. Don't put your faith in man, your boss, your board of directors, that major brand company. They are not God, but depending on how you treat them, they can become God, little g, in your life. I want to say that again. Your boss, your board of directors, that major company you're working for, hoping you work for, they are not God, but depending on how you treat them, they can become God to you. You begin to seek them and serve them for provision. Sometimes it's our children that become the little gods that we run after. Everything, no, we can't go to church, we can't go to cell because of these little guys. Yes, there are times, I know, but sometimes we're actually just throwing a little in the way. Remember, the devil doesn't come at you telling you to murder anyone. He wants to just steal that focus that you have on God. He just wants to take your attention from here on God to here's my problem. Here's my issue. Here's my need. Here's my want. The next thing in the wilderness that scripture says is was to humble you and test you so that in the end it might go well with you. He would rather you go a bit poor on earth and love him and need him than maybe be well off and not need him. You know that? Yes, but JJ, that doesn't make sense. No, it makes sense. Unfortunately, sometimes this flesh of ours, you know, that desire to be comfortable, to want all of these things, sometimes when you're there, you end up not needing God. I mean, how many of you have said, the rich don't need God, the wealthy, they can go to doctors, they can buy whatever they want, they can meet whatever they think their needs are. So sometimes maybe being a bit poor on the earth is keeping you by his side. He's protecting you from you. You know, that verse says, it says, warning us that we won't say at the end of the day, me and my wisdom and my strength got me this wealth. You know, there's nothing worse than when I read a documentary or biography and I hear the guy going, I'm a self-made man. I just think you didn't make one cell in your body. Not one cell. There's a difference between I used what God gave me to I made myself, eh? It's funny, I didn't make my brain, my arms, my legs, and neither did I make the air that I breathe. So why would I hold on to these things? And it's again this human nature that we have that God's protecting us from. Sometimes being in the wilderness, being so reliant on God, he says, because in the end, it will be well with you, because we all realize we are so dependent on him. Think of Moses. God spoke to him through the bush in the desert. David learned who God was in the wilderness. He, in essence, fell in love with God in the desert, and then he stayed with God. JJ learned that God is his source in the wilderness. I didn't learn that when it was going well, I promise you. God knows us better than we know ourselves. Sometimes the thing you're praying for God to remove is the thing keeping you close to him. Sometimes it's the thing that keeps God on the throne in your life. Does it mean he doesn't love you? Does it mean God doesn't love you if you're going in a wilderness? No. Jesus, God's son, was led into the wilderness. So now we're in the same category as Jesus if we're going into a wilderness. Not just that, God led Jesus into the wilderness to test him. Not just that, God allowed his son to die on the cross, his own son. And the devil will come and say, oh, but it's because God doesn't love you and because you're so wrong and all of these things. He wants to diminish what God is teaching you. And all that's happening is, well, I pray. You're just taking a step closer and a step closer and a step closer to God in this time. Trust me, your wilderness you're experiencing does not mean he doesn't love you. It's actually sometimes because he loves you. And then lastly, one of my favorite reasons come from the story we read about Gideon and the 300 men. And this is how it starts. So they're about to go and fight. And Judges 7 verse 1 to 3 says this. So Jerubbaal, or that is Gideon, and his army got up early and went as far as the spring of Harod. The armies of Midian were camping north of them in the valley near the hill of Morah. The Lord said to Gideon, you have too many warriors with you. If I let all of you fight the Midianites, listen here, the Israelites will boast to me that they have saved themselves by their own strength. Therefore tell the people, whoever is timid or afraid, they may leave this mountain and go home. So 22,000 of them went home, leaving only 10,000 who were willing to fight. It's about God and his glory. We keep thinking we are living a story about our own lives, when actually we're in his story. You're not living your own story. You're part of his book. Genesis wrote about God's plan, about his seed. And we become a part of his story. It's not about you, but about God and how he can use you and your knowledge of him. If you just hang in and trust him to get the victory, through you, other people's lives could be saved. You are the testimony that is going to encourage someone else. Your struggle financially can help others see that God has not forsaken them, or that we don't just praise him in the good times. The struggle you may be having in your marriage, once you're through it, will be the story that prevents other people throwing in the towel. You are here for God. You are here for God. Amen. Do you blame God or pursue God when the unexpected happens? Life is full of ups and downs, and yet too often we expect it easier. God wants us to use this time to deepen our attachment to him, to examine our faith, to teach us to rely on him in ways we previously haven't, and to deepen our convictions of the word of God. I want to tell you this, God knows how to get a headline. Young boy, empowered by God, defeats giant. Amen. Miracle as army of 300 defeat enemy army. Jesus' death means victory over sin and its power. What's your headline? God gets the victory in David's life. God gets the victory in Liam's life. God gets the victory in your life. I promise you. When you're in the wilderness, and these are my closing thoughts, draw near to God in prayer. Read the word and spend time with believers. Number two, trust him. He is the great I am. He's with you in the wilderness. I promise you, he's not forsaken you. No, he will never leave you nor forsake you. Believe that he will get the glory through your testimony of your life. If everything you went for as a Christian all the time was always good, everyone would become Christians. Do you realize that? If it just went well all the time, everyone would just become a Christian because, well, whatever I pray for happens. We'd all be living in mansions, but people would start to serve God for what he gives and not for who he is. Do you realize the power of that when you're going through your wilderness and you realize you're worshiping him because of who he is? He's the living God. He's the great I am. And doesn't the worship team want to join me on stage? You know, I really felt God say to me, and this was even while I was driving here this morning, these things are there to let us truly see who he is. despite what you're going through, he says to you, I am more than enough. God is more than enough. You know, the world wants you to look to your finance, to look to your position, and it takes you off your position where you are with God. You're with Christ. You know, this time on earth, it might be tough. You might be struggling with a disease, but you know, not even your disease will take you away from God's hand. It may take your flesh suit away, but it's not going to take your that spirit man, that the real who you are. God wants to say to you, I'm more than enough. Don't turn away from me to other things like drinking, worldly friends, worldly wisdom. Seek me and you will find me. So if you trust him, wait and see. He is the God of the unexpected. Amen. Can I just pray? Yeah. Okay, let's give the Lord a hand. Father, have I enjoyed the wilderness experiences? No. I've cried tears. I've been anxious. I've not known what to do. But every single time, I've drawn closer to you. I've felt your presence. And just like that psalm says, I've gone through that shadow. And Lord, I know that everyone here has got their own story about what they've been through or what they're currently in. I pray that we would learn not to despise the wilderness, but even in that wilderness place, that we would lift our hands to you and say, Lord, I don't know what's going on, but today I choose to praise you. Today I choose to say, you are God, you are my King, you are my Lord, and me and my family, we are going to serve you, we're going to love you. We are going to say that you are good, despite what physically might be going on around me. We can declare you are good because nothing in all creation, the Bible says neither height nor depth, length nor breadth, nothing can separate us from the love of God. And that's why Paul even wrote from prison. I know what it's like to have much. I know what it's like to be with little. But I can do all things through Christ. And Lord, I pray for your strength for those people that are going through that wilderness. I pray that they would get so close to you that they see the cloud in the day and the fire by night to lead them. That all they need to know is you're going to provide manna, you're going to feed them, you're going to keep them safe, and that they can worship you no matter what their circumstances are. So Father, move in our lives and use us as a church, use us as people, use us as a family for your glory, that many, many more would come to know who you are. In Jesus' name, amen.